All right. Hello. Welcome, everybody, to the live stream of Off the Cuff with Adam Banks. We will be on the air in 6 minutes. Gosh, I don't know why. Hi, hello. Hi, yes you are, Valerie. Good to see you. Good to see you too, Nikki. Let's see here. We're going to get started in 4 minutes. We'll be live on the air. That's how we do it. Well, what's new, guys? What's been going on? Tell me something new. Tell me something good. You like the new hairstyle. Well, thank you. First of all, thank you. This is just my regular hair, not fixed. And this is just my hair grown out is what this is. So, that's why it's like this. I have to get a haircut because it's too long to style at this point. I look like I'm 13 years old with this haircut, but let's see, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Nikki says, I'm going on a cruise next week, going from Quebec City down to Boston. That is good news. Valerie's, that is really good news, Nikki. Going to Quebec. Gosh, that's fun. Just for relaxation, Valerie says, I'm done canning vegetables. It was an abundant season. That's good. Yes. So what do you can in the wintertime, or what do you do in the fall? Do you have to do anything in particular to your garden? Or is it just a big mess until the springtime? And I ask because I'm ignorant. It's not, it's just I don't know.
Hi, I'm Lane from Life in the Fast Lane, and you're listening to Radio Lex, the voice of the people, WLXU 93.9 LPFM.
The views expressed on this program are not necessarily the views of Lexington Community Radio or its board of directors. The views expressed are solely those of the programmers.
You are listening to Off the Cuff. Now, here's your host, Adam Banks.
Welcome, everybody, to Off the Cuff. I am Adam Banks coming at you live from Lexington, Kentucky. Thank you for listening to the show, and thank you for tuning in to WLXU 93.9 FM. In addition to listening on the radio, you can check out our Facebook live stream at Off the Cuff with Adam Banks, or you can stream the show live from the station website at radiolex.us to listen to us from anywhere in the entire world. I am broadcasting from the Deborah Hensley Studios here at Radio Lex on North Limestone. It is September the 5th, 2024. I'm always looking for ways to relax. I'm always looking for ways to just relieve my stress. So I thought the other day I would go and get a massage, and it was actually one of the most painful things I've ever done. Literally, I have bruises on my back. This 4'11" woman, weighing probably a whopping 102 pounds, absolutely beat me to a pulp. It looks like when I take my shirt off that I have been the headline of WrestleMania 4. I mean, I completely have been beaten up on my back. And when I looked at my back in the mirror, I thought it was scratches. And I was like, well, that's bizarre. I shouldn't have scratches on my back. But then I touched what I thought was a scratch, and it hurt really, really bad. And I was like, good God, it is bruises. So there we go. I am, if you notice me limping at all on the show thread, it is because I have a bruised back. But folks, we got a lot happening next week. And one of the biggest things happening next week is the presidential debate between Kamala Harris and Donald Trump. And I cannot wait to cover that debate. It's happening this coming Tuesday. And it is going to be must-see TV. So everybody set your DVRs and get ready for some pure entertainment when that comes on. And it amazes me that The Simpsons, an animated TV show, saw this foresight happening years before it even did. I don't know if you guys have ever watched The Simpsons before, or if you ever heard about The Simpsons predicting things on their TV show that comes to fruition. If you've never heard of that, look into it. And that's exactly what I did. The Simpsons, if you don't know what The Simpsons are, it's an animated TV show that's been on since the 90s, and it's the longest running animated TV show in American television history. And what's fascinating about The Simpsons is that it has these uncanny predictions. They predict these things in their show, and it ends up happening in real life. And once or twice, sure, is a coincidence, But the fact that they have several different things that they have predicted on their show that has come true blows my mind. Now, it's been on, it says here, The Simpsons since December 17th, 1989. And it follows the lives of Homer, Marge, Bart, Lisa, and Maggie in the fictional town of Springfield. And it's a great show. But I bring it up, folks, because they had all kinds of things predicted in that show that actually come to fruition. And I would like to share with the audience, because I did some digging, I looked into it, I did some research, and I found a plethora of predictions that The Simpsons got right. Predictions from The Simpsons that came true. And one of the things that they predicted was Kamala Harris being a presidential participant. In an episode in season 11, episode 17, called Bart to the Future, it had Kamala Harris in a presidential role, wearing a distinct purple outfit, similar to what she wore during her 2021 inauguration as vice president. So, to me, the fact that they predicted Kamala Harris being in a presidential role early on in season 11, which was like 1999 of The Simpsons, the fact that they had her in a presidential role just blew my mind. And that's not all, folks. For instance, they predicted the GameStop stock surge. Do you remember that in 2001 when everybody was making a ton of money off the surge of the GameStop stock going up? In season 9, episode 14, in 1998, The Simpsons hinted at the stock market's volatility when Homer invested in this thing called Animotion, which is a stock that skyrocketed, and the scene drew comparisons to the GameStop stock surge orchestrated by Reddit users in early 2021. So it was literally almost over 20 years they predicted the GameStop surge before it even happened. They predicted the U.S. Capitol riot that happened in 2021. They predicted it from an episode in 1996. It says here, season 7, episode 18, called The Day the Violence Died, features an eerily similar scene to the U.S. Capitol riot on January 6, 2021, with characters storming the Capitol. They predicted Donald Trump's presidency that happened in 2016. And it says here that it's one of the most talked about predictions of all time from The Simpsons, and it was on a 2000 episode, and it happened season 11, episode 17, where Donald Trump is depicted as the U.S. president. In the year 2000, they had Donald Trump as president on The Simpsons, and we all know that became a reality in 2016. They predicted the Siegfried and Roy Tiger attack. Do you guys remember the big tiger extravaganza show that they always had in Vegas? They predicted that tiger attacking one of those guys in 1993, and we all know that it really happened in 2003. And this happened on an episode in season 5, episode 10, years before it even happened. The Simpsons predicted smartwatches in 1995. They had Lisa wearing a futuristic watch that allowed users to make phone calls that resemble watches today. They predicted in The Simpsons the 2014 Ebola outbreak, and they predicted that in an episode from 1997, season 9, episode 3, that shows Marge suggesting a sick Bart read a book titled Curious George and the Ebola Virus. And we know that the Ebola outbreak occurred in 2014, highlighting yet again another Simpson prediction. Disney buys 20th Century Fox is another prediction that the Simpsons got right. Disney really did buy Fox in 2017. They bought 20th Century Fox in 2017. But the Simpsons predicted that they were going to do that in a 1998 episode. Season 10, episode 5, it's called When You Dish Upon a Star, and it depicted 20th Century Fox as a division of the Walt Disney Company. What? Okay, there's more here. The Greece financial crisis in 2010, they predicted a Lady Gaga's Super Bowl performance that happened in 2017. They predicted it in a 2012 episode where they had Lady Gaga performing at the Super Bowl, and a lot of the things in the episode Lady Gaga actually did during her Super Bowl performance. They predicted that the U.S. would win the Olympic gold in curling. We know that that really did happen in 2018, but The Simpsons said it would happen back on a 2010 episode. And it was when Homer and Marge compete in a curling contest at the Winter Olympics, and they win the gold. The U.S. men's curling team won its first ever gold in 2018. Yet again, folks, making another Simpsons prediction come true. They predicted other things, like the Richard Branson's space lift. They predicted Brent Holmstrom winning the Nobel Peace Prize. He won it in 2016. They said he would win it in a 2010 episode of The Simpsons. They also predicted the horse meat scandal. Do you guys remember the horse meat scandal in 2013? Well, The Simpsons said that the horse meat scandal would happen in 1994 in an episode in season 5. It says here that this episode is where Doris, a character on The Simpsons, she's the lunch lady, she used assorted horse parts in school lunches. And this eerily mirrored the 2013 horse meat scandal in Europe, where horse meat was found in various beef products. So a lot of things The Simpsons got right that it just makes it really scary when you look into it. So when The Simpsons has something on television that they're saying is going to happen, you can't just scave over it. You can't just turn a blind eye to it. There's a good chance that it could come to fruition. There's the autocorrect fails that happened in 2007. The Simpsons predicted it to happen in 1994, episode 6 of season 8. A school bully writes a memo that gets autocorrected to beat up Martin. This early depiction of autocorrect just mirrored what happened in the year 2007 when the autocorrect scandal happened. So much happened, and there's a ton more. And I want to break this list up. I'll share more with you throughout the show. But The Simpsons, folks, who would have ever thought that The Simpsons could predict a lot of the things that have come to fruition today? But folks, we have a great show ahead of you today. You are listening to Off the Cuff with Adam Banks. Stick with us. We will be right back.
To Radio Lex, the voice of the people. WLXU 93.9 LPFM, Lexington, Kentucky.
Radio Lex only exists in our community because of the generosity of supporting members like Laura McDonald. Thank you for your ongoing.
That's a good question, Valerie. He must be.
To learn how you can become a supporting member, visit.
He really must be.
.us/donate. Kentucky child seat laws are designed to keep kids safe on the road. Any child shorter than 3.5 feet must ride an infant or child seat. Children between 3.5 and 4.5 feet must be secured in a booster seat to ride. Children over 4.5 feet or age 8 must ride wearing a seatbelt. Hi, this is Annie with State Farm, reminding you to be a good neighbor and check your child's safety before you hit the road.
UV is high.
Radio Lex has the support of Cy Pugh. Thanks, Cy.
Everybody, to Off the Cuff. Adam Banks here with you. The wait is over. NFL football is officially back, and the NFL season kicks off tonight at 8:20 p.m. with a Thursday night football matchup that includes the Baltimore Ravens taking on the Kansas City Chiefs. And what you hear right now is Carrie Underwood, who so many people around the world have come to know, and partly because of her being the voice of the NFL Sunday night anthem theme. It's called Waiting All Day for Sunday Night. What a great intro. This was a song by Joan Jett and the Blackhearts, and it was reworked by pop star Pink, who was the original performer, and then Faith Hill took it over from 2007 to 2012. And now, Carrie Underwood has been doing it since 2013. And you got to give credit to Carrie Underwood, because Carrie Underwood, after every song, she doesn't just sing this song one time. She sings this song to include every single possible sports matchup during Sunday night football. So every Sunday, the lyrics change depending on the two teams that are playing. So everybody will be hearing that this Sunday, and I know that you are excited. There is a lot of power when it comes to NFL and their theme music. There is no other sport that gives you that much hype when it comes to theme music. So much that you could just happily watch a game on television the same way you can in person. It's just as exciting these days to watch football on television than it is going to a game, and partly because of the music. Sunday night blues are no longer an issue, folks, from September until early February, thanks to the NFL. And folks, I have on the show before, I've talked about some of the best MLB broadcast theme songs of all time. I've talked about some of the best NBA broadcast theme songs of all time. But folks, what I would like to talk about in light of the NFL football season starting tonight, I would like to talk about the best NFL broadcast theme songs of all time. And when the NFL broadcasts on a particular network, that particular network has their own theme song for football. So NBC's got a theme song, CBS has a theme song, Fox has a theme song. Whoever shows NFL games has their own particular theme song. And what I love about NFL theme music is that every single one of them are great. So what I have done is compiled a list of some of the best NFL theme broadcast theme songs of all time. And we will start, folks, with this little ditty right here. This is Thursday Night Football on Prime Video. Now, you're going to be hearing this theme tonight because the NFL Thursday Night Football is exclusively on Prime. You can't watch it on any other network other than Prime. Back in the day, streaming was not very popular because you really couldn't watch sports on streaming. That was one of the flaws of streaming. But now, oh boy, can you ever watch sports on a streaming service. You can only watch Thursday Night Football exclusively on Prime Video. So if you don't have Prime, Amazon Prime, you're not watching Thursday Night Football tonight. But if you do tune in, you're going to hear this little ditty right here. This is the Thursday Night Football theme for Amazon Prime, which is a streaming network. Now, I would say that this being the newest theme song of the NFL networks, because this is a new coverage, it's hard to put Amazon's Prime theme music for Thursday Night Football anything other than the bottom of the list. It simply does not have the history that the other networks have. But this is a great theme song. And of course, folks, you know there's more networks that show NFL games. Like ESPN always shows Monday Night Football, which means ESPN has their own broadcast network theme for the NFL. This is arguably one of the most iconic theme songs of all the networks. This is the Monday Night Football coverage theme. And this song is entitled Heavy Action by Johnny Pearson. And it's been the theme for quite some time. It was composed in 1970 and it was first used for ABC's Monday Night Football coverage before becoming the official theme in 1989. A new recording of the song was set up when Monday Night Football was reintroduced in 2006. It's an iconic theme song, but it doesn't really have the same impact as the other songs that I'm going to include on this list, but there's a lot of history behind this song. If this doesn't get you hyped for a game, I don't know what will. Monday Night Football. Prime time. Okay, coming up next, folks, on my list is one of the best NFL broadcast theme songs of all time, is going to come from Fox. And I feel like Fox actually might take the cake as having the best NFL theme song of all time. This is one of the most well-known theme songs of all the NFL broadcast. It is commonly used on TikTok content, which makes everything more popular and more mainstream these days. When you hear this melody on Sunday afternoons, you know that you're about to dive in to some football. Your Sunday has begun. It was created by Scott Schrier and originally inspired by a 1989 Batman film. It was first used for NFL coverage in 1994 and has since been used on Fox's MLB coverage from 2010 to 2019. But this is the NFL on Fox. Yes. All right, coming up next on my list, folks, is one of the best NFL broadcast themes of all time. Comes from the network CBS. Perhaps this is lesser known than the Fox coverage theme song, but there are not many networks that hype you up for a game as much as CBS does for their NFL coverage. The current theme music was first used in 2003, and it was an adaptation of the song Pompilay by E.S. Pothamosus. Ever since then, the song has been synonymous with the CBS coverage. Not only do we see it in the regular season, but we often see it used for conference championship games, no matter which conference they are showing you. This theme music makes you want to go into battle. It's a battle where you just want to run through a wall and you want to win the battle. It gets you excited about the game. It does exactly what any sports coverage should do. It gets you pumped. It gets you excited. So well done, CBS, on a great network theme music for your NFL broadcast coverage. Okay, folks. Coming up next on my list is one of the best NFL broadcast theme songs of all time. Is going to be from NBC when they show their Sunday night football coverage. I tell you, NBC is a close number one right beside a Fox. Some say it could even be number one because this is a great package. And folks, if you're wondering why this is such a good theme song, it's because it was created by the iconic John Williams. John Williams, of course, is the composer behind the music of Jaws and Star Wars, Home Alone. He also did the NBC Nightly News theme. There's nothing that John Williams can't do. And he's also the mastermind behind the NBC Sunday Night Football theme. That's why when you are watching a football game and you hear this music come on, that's why you feel like there's something truly epic about to happen. Because it gives you that movie feeling. It gives you that something big is getting ready to occur feeling. So NBC Sunday Night Football is the most watched broadcast of the entire weekend. So it makes sense that this is the most famous of all of the NFL broadcast themes. It's not just the song by John Williams that is the staple of the NBC network, but it's also got the Carrie Underwood song that I included at the beginning of this segment, which is a great song, but you can't take anything away from the NBC Sunday Night Football theme music. All right, coming up next, folks, on my list as one of the best NFL broadcast theme songs of all time, and this is the last one that I will play, and this comes from the NFL Network. The NFL Network doesn't show many NFL games, but it will still carry a package of exclusive games consisting mainly of international games and late season Saturday games. But nonetheless, the NFL Network is still a network that has football coverage. So in return, they have their own NFL broadcast theme music. This, when I hear this music, it just reminds me that I got work the next morning. I got to go to school. I'd say a lot of kids listening to this, this probably triggers a lot of bad memories in your mind, thinking, oh my gosh, I've got a lot of homework due in just 12 hours. So many great NFL broadcast theme songs. Nobody does broadcast theme music like the NFL. And you're going to be hearing all of these this week and for many weeks to come until the season is over. So in honor of the NFL kicking off tonight between the Baltimore Ravens and the Kansas City Chiefs, I wanted to do a segment where we celebrated the great NFL broadcast theme songs of all time. All right, folks, stick with us. We still have more Off the Cuff coming at you live after these words.
Hi, my name is Eileen Connor from Leadership Lexington Youth. You are listening to Radio Lex, the voice of the people. WLXU 93.9 LPFM, Lexington, Kentucky.
Let's go places safely, Lexington. Has your drive got you riled up? Are you running late? Is everyone in your way? Driving while impatient or upset increases your likelihood of a crash. Take a deep breath. Focus on where you are, not where you need to be. Check your mirrors. Relax your grip on the steering wheel. If your emotions are still getting in the way, get off the road. Get out of your car, stretch, or take a quick walk. In 5 years, you probably won't remember this drive at all. Hi, I'm Kim Sweezy from Toyota, reminding you to take a moment to cool down and get where you're going safely.
Renee Cobb, host of Overtones Live. Are you tired of hearing the same songs over and over across the radio dial? Radio Lex spins over 5,000 unique songs each month in English on 93.9 FM and Spanish on 95.7 FM. Hear everything from soul to hip-hop, classical to jazz, salsa to mariachi, and Americana to good old rock and roll. It takes a great community to make great community radio. We can't do it without you. Support the voice of the people today. Visit radiolex.us/donate and support Lexington's community radio right now.
Avoid a ticket by keeping your vehicle registration current. To renew your registration, visit your county clerk's office and present a photo ID, expiring registration, and proof of insurance. You'll get a sticker for your license plate, and you'll be set for another year. Hi, this is Annie with State Farm, reminding you to be a good neighbor. Keep yourself updated and obey Kentucky's insurance and registration laws.
Radio Lex only exists in our community because of the generosity of supporting members like Melissa Tibbs. Thank you for your ongoing commitment to the voice of the people. To learn how you can become a supporting member, visit radiolex.us/donate.
Everybody to Off the Cuff. Adam Banks here with you. At the top of the show, we were talking about the predictions from the animated TV show The Simpsons that came true and sparked a lot of conversation on the show thread. Valerie says, that's remarkable. Is the writer a clairvoyant? Well, that's a good question. Maybe. There's got to be some type of spiritual thing going on there with the writer of The Simpsons. Because I can see it happening once or twice, but the fact that it keeps happening and over 30 documented predictions that you can verify, to me, there's just something behind that. Jake on the show thread says Springfield was a name chosen because every state in the country has a Springfield. Means Homer and Marge could be any family in America just scraping by. That's interesting. Well, that's a fascinating Simpsons fact. Well, since the show, folks, we started the show talking about The Simpsons and some of their predictions, I would like to continue with more predictions from The Simpsons that have came true. They predicted the three-eyed fish that was discovered in 2011. A three-eyed fish was found in Argentina in a reservoir, and it was received from a nuclear plant because of the water surrounding the nuclear plant. It caused a three-eyed fish. Well, The Simpsons predicted the three-eyed fish in 1990 in an episode from season 2, episode 4. It's where Bart catches a three-eyed fish and named him Blinky. And he found the fish, get this, in a nuclear power plant, which is pretty much what happened in 2011. So 21 years earlier, The Simpsons predicted the three-eyed fish. The Simpsons, they predicted the faulty voting machines that happened in 2012. In a 2008 episode, season 20, episode 4, entitled Treehouse of Horror, Homer tries to vote for Barack Obama, but the machine changes his vote to John McCain. In 2012, similar incidents were reported where voting machines changed votes from Obama to Mitt Romney. Also, there was a prediction in 2005, episode 16, season 16, episode 8, there was a prediction where Homer and... Okay, let me just start this over. In 2005, episode 8, season 16, Homer and Ned's Hail Mary Pass was the title of the episode. Homer and Marge are shown beating Tiger Woods in a golf game, which many saw as predicting Tiger Woods' fall from grace due to his personal life scandals in 2009. So the whole Tiger Woods scandal was predicted by The Simpsons. The Shard in London, which was an event that happened in 2009, was predicted in a 1995 episode of The Simpsons. In season 6, episode 19, Lisa's future visit to London shows a skyscraper resembling the Shard behind the Tower Bridge. The Shard was completed in 2012, years after the episode aired. The Simpsons predicted virtual reality games. In a 1998 episode, season 9, episode 12, a character is shown playing a virtual reality game, much like the virtual reality gaming systems that became widely available in the mid-2010s. So they were playing with virtual reality games in The Simpsons in the late 90s. But it didn't really become a thing, folks, until the mid-2010s. Farmville and Virtual Farms was predicted by The Simpsons. It says here in a 1998 episode, season 9, episode 12, the character is seen obsessing over a virtual farm game, which resembled the popular Facebook game Farmville, which emerged in 2009. So they were playing Farmville on The Simpsons in 1998, and they were talking about the addiction of this Facebook game in 1998. Facebook didn't even exist back then. And look at what happened in 2009. The Simpsons got it right again. Here is an interesting one. In a 2000 episode, season 11, episode 17, a scene shows Donald Trump riding down an escalator. And this is eerie, similar to his real-life announcement of his presidential campaign in 2015 when he's riding the escalator right before or after he announces his campaign. The Simpsons had that same scene of him riding that escalator in the year 2000, and it came to fruition in real life in 2015. That is absolutely insane. There was the NSA spying scandal in The Simpsons movie in 2007. The NSA is shown listening to citizens' conversations. This predicted the real-life NSA spying scandal revealed by Edward Snowden in 2013. Let's see. There are more here. The Simpsons predicted FaceTime. In a 1995 episode, season 6, Lisa's future character shows her video chatting on a telephone which resembles the modern-day FaceTime that we have on our iPhones today. They predicted the Apple iPod in 1996, season 8, episode 5, where a character uses a music device with white earphones, which many believe predicted the design of Apple's iPod and its iconic earbuds. So many people think not only is The Simpsons predicting these things, but people are copying The Simpsons' ideas and just making them a reality. It says here that another prediction made by The Simpsons was the censoring of Michelangelo's David. You guys remember the Michelangelo's David statue, the one with him standing there naked? Well, in a 1990 episode, season 2, episode 9, Springfield residents protest against Michelangelo's statue of David being exhibited, which actually came to fruition in 2016 when protesters in Russia were advocating that the statue have clothes wrapped around him. So there you go. Another crazy Simpsons prediction. Another Simpsons prediction is virtual yard work. In season 6, episode 19, aired in 1995, a scene depicts a future where yard work is done via virtual reality, similar to the robot lawnmowers that are available on the market today. Well, The Simpsons predicted that happening back in 2001, folks. And then finally here, The Simpsons predicted 9-11. 11, which happened in 2001. They predicted it in a 1997 episode, season 9, episode 1. It was called The City of New York versus Homer Simpson. It's basically where a magazine cover shows the number 9 with the Twin Towers in the background, resembling the date 9/11. While this prediction is more of a coincidence, it is often cited as a very scary prediction that the Simpsons got. So, very interesting just to hear about some of the predictions that the Simpsons made about what would happen in the world that actually come true. So when you're watching The Simpsons, just know if it seems very far-fetched and it seems like all that would never happen in real life, well, if you were watching any other TV show, I would say, yeah, it probably won't happen in real life. Unless you're watching The Simpsons. It just appears that everything that they do on that show just keeps coming true, and it absolutely blows my mind. But this seems like a good place to take Off the Cuff's Song of the Week, and why not a little Lady Gaga? It's been a while since we heard from her. She's got a new song out, doing a duet with Bruno Mars. It's called Die with a Smile. Enjoy. We'll be back after the song. Woke up from a dream, you and I. Whew. Yes, thank you, thank you, thank you. Valerie, thank you so much. Let's see if the show, is the show going across on the radio? Can anybody like on the show thread tune in on the app and tell me if it is going through? Because we had some problems last week with it. Today's national holiday is National Cheese Pizza Day. So you may be familiar with National Pizza Day on February the 9th. It's an iconic day, but folks, we make our own day for one of the best types of pizzas that you can get, and that is just a plain cheese pizza. It says here that the first pizza establishment in the Western world opened in 1905 in Little Italy in New York. It wasn't until 1939 that the Damore family introduced pizza to Los Angeles, and the dish had officially made it across the country. The popularity of pizza in the U.S. rose dramatically following World War II. Veterans returning from the Italian campaign, who had been introduced to the Italy native cuisine, led the increase of consumption of pizza at the time. And think about how popular pizza is today. And today we are celebrating just a specific type of pizza, and that is a plain cheese pizza. Cheese pizza has had an impact on pop culture. I mean, think about it. That was Kevin McAllister's favorite type of pizza to buy. It was the Ninja Turtles' favorite type of pizza to get. Think about how prolific the Ninja Turtles were in the 90s and beyond. That was their favorite food, was cheese pizza. That was always Joey's on Friends' favorite type of pizza to get. Cheese pizza, folks, and it's just a great snack. And it says here that 3 billion pizzas are sold every year in the U.S. That's a lot of pizza. There are 350 slices of pizza sold every second. 41% of Americans are, 41% is what Americans eat of pizza every single week. There are 70,000 pizzerias in the U.S. There are 40 billion pizza industries in the U.S. That's the size of the pizza industry in the U.S. $40 billion. $40 billion is how big the pizza industry is. 46 is the amount of slices of pizza eaten each year by the average person. There are 6,600 pizzerias in California alone, but that is more than any other state. It says here that 59% of adults prefer pizza as a dinner option. 51 pounds is the weight of the largest pizza ever made, and it says here that 93% of Americans will eat pizza at least once in the next 30 days. Americans order an average of 350 slices of pizza per second. I find that fascinating. 61% of people refer to order thin crust pizza over thick or deep dish. They purchase more than $4 billion worth of cheese every year. The average pizzeria goes through roughly 55 pizza boxes per day. 36% of people say pizza is the perfect breakfast. You know what? Not really the perfect breakfast, but I can get behind having pizza for breakfast. Pizza is such a great dish. I know that it didn't come from America, but just think about how Americans love that Italy cuisine. We love it. We eat it up. We can't get enough of it. So here are some ways that you can celebrate National Cheese Pizza Day. You can go have yourself a pizza party, go to a pizza party, host a pizza party. You can get your hands on a cheese pizza by just picking up the phone and ordering a plain cheese pizza, or find a local pizza museum somewhere near you, or if you can't find one near you, just go to one and learn more about pizza, and I bet you anything they'll have probably pizza in there for you to eat. But happy National Cheese Pizza Day, folks. Such a great food day to have in America. Who doesn't love pizza? All right, folks, we've got one more segment to go. Stick with us. We will be right back. back, everybody, to Off the Cuff. Adam Banks here with you at last segment of the hour. On today's broadcast, we talked about some great NFL broadcast theme songs, and we talked about how great the NFL is. But folks, college football is in full swing as well. The Kentucky Wildcats, they kicked off their season last Saturday. It was an easy game, Southern Miss. I don't think anybody predicted them to lose that game. It was a give me. You know how Stoopsie loves his give me's. But in light of the Kentucky football season started, I would like to officially preview the 2024-2025 football schedule. Now, I know what you're thinking, Adam, the season's already started. Oh, come on. That first game was a give me. We won it, and we won by a lot. Now, speaking of that game, the most bizarre broadcast of a UK football game in my fandom, in my lifetime. There might have been more bizarre games than that, but to me, that was a bizarre game, and it was all due to the weather delays. I have watched Kentucky football for a long time, and never in my life of watching Kentucky football did the game not happen because of a delay, and it kept getting pushed back. It was supposed to start at 7:30, 7:45-ish. The game didn't even get started until a little bit after 10 o'clock, but Kentucky, they held them scoreless, and they ended up winning the game. So I think it's time for Kentucky to start beating some really good teams too, not just the Southern Misses and the EKUs of the world. So let's preview the 2024-2025 Kentucky Wildcats football schedule, and we'll start with just talking about the players really quick. I'm very excited to see what our quarterback can do going forward. He looked good in his first game. That was Brock Vandergriff. He was a superstar prospect from Atlanta, and he was supposed to be a star on the Georgia football team. You know, that football team that's number one in the entire country. Well, because they have so much talent on that team. Carson Beck, for instance. When he announced he was coming back, guess what? Brock Vandergriff said, I'm not going to get any playing time. So he decided to come be our quarterback for Kentucky so he could really make this team a great team. I think that with him being our quarterback, I think that we have a solid team. We've got great players. We've got Deion Walker. We've got Maxwell Harrison. We've got Eli Cox, Barry Brown, Dane Key. We've got a ton of great UK football players. But let's run through the schedule really quick. We've got four road games, Ole Miss, Florida, Tennessee, and Texas. But hey, that's the cost of doing business in the SEC. When you play in the best football conference in the league, you're going to get some really hard games. Now, who do I think will beat out of those road games? I think that we can beat Florida. I think Florida is experiencing some dark days down there in Gainesville, and it could not make me happier. I think we'll lose to Ole Miss. I think we'll lose to Tennessee. I think we'll lose to Texas, but I think that we will pull out that Florida win. It's 50-50, really, with those games, but I do think that we can pull that out. We have no Alabama. We have no LSU. We don't have Missouri, which is usually a give me for Kentucky. But I feel like that's a plus this season, not having those three games on our schedule. But it's probably not a bad thing that we're missing out on Oklahoma and Texas A&M too, who was also, or Oklahoma's been included on our SEC conference schedule. But we don't have them this year. I dread that game. It's going to be fun, probably seeing Jim Ross from the WWF on the sidelines at UK. But until we have to play him, I'm not going to ache for that game to happen. Our likely losses are going to be Georgia. Come on now. It's time to beat Georgia. We've not beaten Georgia in, 20 years? Maybe even over 20 years. 16? I don't know. It's been too long. It's time to beat Georgia. For somebody who gets all this praise as being such a great coach, man, still can't beat Georgia. Still can't beat Georgia. I think that we'll win the give-me's. That's Murray State, Ohio. We did beat Southern Miss, and I think we'll beat Vanderbilt. So I think that that puts Kentucky with 6 wins this season. I see the Cats going 6-5. That will satisfy Kentucky fans, and Stoop will continue to get his praise from all of those guys that love Stoops. But I think that we're looking at 6 wins, which would get us to some decent food bowl at the end of the season. And there you go. I think that's what Kentucky's looking at. The Cats have a day game this Saturday. Their next game is against South Carolina starting at 3:30. I don't look for there to be any delays, and I look for that game to be a win by the Cats. I see us winning that one, which would put us 2-0. Now, we've got a tough schedule going forward after that. That's why I'm only giving us 6 wins. I still, to me, not good enough. I think that I'm not going to get on my Mark Stoops soapbox just yet. There's still so much time to get on that as the season progresses. But I'm giving us 6 wins, which, hey, I think that will satisfy a lot of Kentucky fans. Not me so much, but I think for the most part it will satisfy a lot of them. But folks, that pretty much wraps up another episode of Off the Cuff with Adam Banks. If you like what you heard today, you'll probably like our previous episodes. We are on Spotify, Apple, YouTube, or wherever you stream your favorite podcast. You can follow the show on social media at Off the Cuff with Adam Banks. You can follow me, the host, on social media at The Adam Banks. We release new episodes every Thursday from 4 to 5 right here on WLXU 93.9 FM. Every Thursday at 4 o'clock, which means we will be back same time, same place. Ladies and gentlemen, this is Off the Cuff, and I am the king of radio, Adam Banks. I will see you next week. Some of your order establishments here in New York called hot pies on pizza. Have you ever heard of the term? Hot pies? No, I didn't know that hot pies was even a thing. Interesting. Well, listen, guys, I got to go to let the next person in to do their show. Love you.